Okay, so welcome to the first ever Ask GMBN Tech. Hopefully I'm gonna answer all your questions. We've been inundated with stuff already, so I've just picked out a whole bunch of those good questions. We're gonna answer them now. Don't forget to email in. The email address is on the screen if you want your questions answered, or you can comment below with the hashtag AskGMBNTech. So let's get cracking. Okay, so jumping right in with the very first question on Ask GMBN Tech. This is from ANZE GALE. Hey guys, I've just bought a brand new Shimano Z shifter and I want to know how to maintain it and to keep it stiff and smooth. Well, firstly, I'm not really sure what you mean by stiff. I'm assuming that's something to do with making sure the gears are working correctly, in which case you want to look at the barrel adjuster on there and just make sure you're keeping an eye on that. The most important thing for any shifting though is making sure that the inner cable is running smooth inside the outer cable. So make sure that it's always clean and fresh as much as it can be. Replace your inner cable when you're riding in wet conditions as often as needs be. And pay attention to the insides of your shifter as well, because when you're riding in those wet conditions, it's one of the parts of the bike that can actually trap water in there and you might not necessarily think of taking a look to maintain it. Now I'm just gonna throw you to a video I did recently on where to use grease on a bike, because I actually take apart a shifter and show you exactly how to do that. Now when using grease inside your shifter to keep it working nice and smoothly like you want, make sure you only use a very thin grease. So I recommend a spray grease for this because you can put it exactly where you want to. Don't have to get your hands messy and it does the job perfectly. Okay, so now for a slightly shorter set of questions. So first up is from Ryan Richard Dort. Thank you very much for all your suggestions for the things we could do on the channel, by the way, really helpful. Definitely gonna be looking into a couple of those. But I'm just gonna answer a couple of your questions first. So first one is, why are people so afraid of grip shift? I think it's a bit of a Marmite thing. You either love it or hate it. It's a very strange thing to shift with if you're used to your regular shifters. So if you bear in mind what I consider a regular shifter, that is your under the bar shifter, your thumb is naturally in that position, so it feels logical to just hit that button and change gear. But with a grip shifter, you've actually got a twist to change gear. And although that's a natural movement to do with your wrist, it's a bit of an odd thing to do when you're actually riding on the trail, despite how intuitive it could be. I actually quite like grip shift, but I would never use them. They totally do not work with my riding style. And I think that is what you're getting at with people saying that they're scared of them. I don't think they're scared, they just don't like using them. It is a preference thing. So SRAM, for example, bought grip shift back again from the grave because I haven't been around for many years. And they are really popular, especially with the XC guys. It's a super lightweight setup. So if you're looking at saving weight on your bike, it's a really good thing to do. And we've also seen riders like Jerome Clements using a grip shifter, so he uses the left-hand one, which would normally be for your front derailleur. Of course, he doesn't have one, he runs a one-by system. He uses his to actuate the lockout on his rear shock. So that's a really cool way of incorporating that into his bike, and it's not being used for changing gear. Don't know, what do you guys think of grip shift? Let us know in the comments below. I'd like to know if you love them or hate them. So number two, what are we giving up with sub 70 degree head angles in cross country, and what are the pros running? I'm not really sure what the pros are running, but I'm going to find out and come back to you on that in another show. But what are we giving up with sub 70 degree head angles? I don't think we're giving up anything. Okay, so at slow speed, they do definitely make your bike feel more responsive. And you might argue that the bike can feel a bit more like a road bike, and a lot of cross-country races might use road bikes for training on, so there's a bit of similarity between the two. But actually, the slacker you go, the more you're gonna get out of the bike. You're gonna be able to ride it faster with more stability. Now, of course, there is a limit. So for a cross-country race, but I'd be quite happy going as slack as 67 degrees or even 66, but I'm not really a cross-country rider. I just see the benefits in slacker geometry. So answer your question, I don't think I've given up anything. Go slacker, always. Okay, we've got a great question here from Beau Charnock. Hi guys, I'm hoping you can help me save my sanity. Well, I hope you can too. I have some Suntour Radon air forks. They've got 120mm travel and 32mm stanchions. I really want to add a couple of air tokens to them to stiffen up the ride without any additional air in there. And according to the Suntour website, they're available specifically for that fork to purchase, but I can't source them anywhere. If you can put me in the right direction, I'd really appreciate it. There's lots of online info about the top end stuff from Fox and RockShox, but nothing about budget end where most of us reside. I do think that GMBN, Seth's bikes, etc., all forget the ordinary guy. I'll never own a 2 grand bike. Forget about the dearest stuff. Okay, so let's pick this up at the bottom here. I'm actually riding a Nukeproof Scout Pro, so in the UK that's just under 1100 quid. And my aim is to show you that you don't need a really expensive bike. Now you can see that in a recent video I made for GMBN, where I'm riding that and Blake's riding his super high-end enduro bike. And we went and had a great day out riding on some really rocky terrain. So it goes to show you don't need to have an expensive bike. And I'm quite happy to help you fight your corner on that one. But for the Suntour volume spaces, that is a bit more of a problem. So I too did a bit of web scouring to try and find out for you. And the only place I was able to find them online was on the Suntour North America website. And they sell them for $295 each, but they do worldwide shipping. So hopefully that can help you. There's a link in the description below there. So hopefully you can get those and get them on your bike. If you want to know how to fit them, I'm just going to throw you to a video where I showed everyone how to fit volume spacers on Fox and RockShox forks. Now, this wasn't elitist. I use these because they're the most common forks that most bikes do come with these days. But the principle is the same for all forks. So have a look at that and it'll give you an idea how to fit them when you do get hold of them. The RockShox system is very simple. All you need to do is simply screw in the required amount of spacers that you want into the top. They've got plastic thread on them, so you don't want to over tighten them. If you feel you need to nip it up tighter, there is an 8mm Allen key socket on the inside there, so you can just stack them up as you like. Bit of sleuthing around to do here, because Chris Hill's seen a pair of shoes online that look like they could be the new Giro chamber shoes, and he wants to know if we've got anything to add or if we've even seen them. So no, I haven't actually seen them, but I've been chatting to my friends there and they do say there's a new shoe on the horizon, and I'm going to have pictures of that very soon. So as soon as I'm allowed to share them with you, they'll be on the GMBN Tech show, so keep an eye out for that. Okay, so this one is for the taller riders out there. Chris Imp, he actually dropped me a line via the Facebook page and he said he's seen my Nukeproof Mega 290 bike check, and like myself, he's 6'4", I'm 6'3". And he's searching for an enduro bike that really fits him. He wanted to know about the Mega. At the moment, he's riding a Giant Rain, a 2016 model, and wanted to ask some advice for cockpit setup for tall riders. So I absolutely love the Mega, and the reason for that is it's got a really decent modern geometry, long wheelbase, a really good reach on there. It's 515 reach, so it's probably the longest of most sort of production bikes that aren't on the too extreme side like that pole. And the reason I really love this bike is it's so similar in geometry to one of my all-time favourites, which is the Mondraker Foxy. But the thing about the Nukeproof I like better than Foxy is the fact it's got 29-inch wheels, and that really suits me as a big rider, because the bottom bracket point on a 29-inch wheel bike is a lot lower in relation to the wheel axles, so that makes a dramatic difference on stability compared to a 27.5-inch wheel bike. But as far as the cockpit goes, if you go for a wider bar, that's obviously going to help give you a bit more room. But bear in mind, the wider bar you go, you're going to need to go for a slightly shorter stem. So just think about this. If you're moving your hands far apart, it's going to move you forwards. So you're going to need to counter that by bringing the stem back. And vice versa, if you want to put a longer stem on there, you're going to need to go for a shorter bar to get that same effect. So you can play around with that quite a lot to get different cockpit setups. Now, I run a full 38mm rise bar with a full 800mm width, and I rather very slightly forwards, and I try not to go too high on the steerer tube with spacers underneath, because the higher you go on the steerer tube, the shorter effective top tube you have. Because of the angle of the head tube, you're actually making your effective top tube shorter by bringing it back towards you. Now, this can only be 5-10mm, but that does make a bit of difference. When you find your sweet spot, it's really important, especially for the taller riders, to make a note of that, because you can get the setup right on your next bike a lot easier. So what I recommend doing is, once you do find that, measuring the distance from the end of your bars to the ground. Obviously that will differ between 29-inch wheel bikes and 27.5. And the other distance you really want to take into account is your bottom bracket axle up to the center of the bars. Now, that's kind of the similar principle to measuring reach, but it's a bit more of an accurate way for you measuring it on each bike, the way you travel across. It's the distance between where your feet are going to be when you're stood up and where your bars are. Of course, you have to factor in the height of your bars as well, the rise on them, so 10, 20, 30, 38 mil, and how you like to roll them back and forth. Just take note of that, and it's going to be a lot easier for you to get your bike set up. Okay, so Tanner Carl has sent in a shot of his rear shock from the drive side. That looks fine. On the other side, it looks like the seal has slipped down. And he says he's noticed an abnormal amount of grease buildup on the O-ring as well, but he's thought nothing of it because it's just been in for service. So, well, picking up on that service point, yeah, you are right there. Normally that grease will purge out after you've serviced the shock, because you don't actually need the grease on the inside of the shock for performance. All it is there for is to wipe on the inside of the wiper seal to help keep the water out and make a good seal. So of course, under the first few cycles, you're gonna get some of that grease purging out, and you do get that from time to time. That's nothing to be too concerned about. Just make sure you clean it off properly with a rag. But more interestingly is what you can see on screen now. It does look like the seal has slipped, or it might be damaged. It is actually hard to see in that picture. Now, if it's damaged, you're gonna need a new seal. But if it's just not seated properly, really in your case, it's down to whoever serviced it, because it doesn't look like they pushed it back and seated it properly. But that is something you can deal with yourself. Okay, so if you do need to reseat that, it's no biggie. You can do that yourself if you're comfortable with doing it. So the way to do that is to make sure you deflate all of the air out of the main valve on the shock, and then you want to unscrew the air can from the shock, and then remove the shock from the bike. Take the air can straight off. It'll be a bit of a as you pull this thing off, and then you get access to the seal itself, which you can reseat. If you're not comfortable doing that, do make sure you take it back to whoever serviced your shock and get them to do it. But of course, if it is damaged, you might want them to look at that first. I'm just gonna throw you to a video on shock volume spacer installation, because that is, although you don't need to install volume spacers, it does show you how to remove that can safely. So check this video out. Next up, simply take the air can and pull it down and off the shock. There we go. As you can see, there's one band on here already. I'm gonna put two more on just to show you the process. Make sure you don't cover up the air port at the end. Okay, so this question is a great one. It's from Ronald Guillaume, who's in Singapore. It's tech related and it's bike related, but it's not actually related to a bike itself. And I quite like this. So they're a huge fan of GMBN. So thank you for subscribing and following what we do. I was just wondering, what's the model of your custom mounted bar remote that you mentioned for your action selfie that you're using with a Canon camera? So I posted a photo on my Instagram page of myself riding, basically, and I've got this selfie setup, which you're gonna see in a video very shortly on GMBN, where I can take a full action photo by remotely triggering my camera, which is on a tripod down the trail from the handlebars. So it's basically a 3.5 to 3.5 mil jack cable, which I've snipped in half and got a push to close little remote. And you can get those from Radio Shack, Maplin, Tandy, all those sort of home electronic shops. Soldered that on, and I've bodged it onto the handlebars, which you'll see in the video, using a really old Crank Brothers dropper post remote. It's a really, really cool system. And in that video, I'm going to show you how to take action selfies and basically make your Instagram page look amazing. So keep an eye out for that video dropping soon. So each week on Ask Tech GMBN, I want to throw you to a really good tech related mountain bike video that exists. Now, it could be an old video that you might not have seen, or it could be a brand new video. Now, I've just watched this one and it is outstanding. It's from YT Bikes, and it's all about the story of the company and how it happened. And I didn't know a lot of this story myself, so I think it's really cool to see this, how it started as a dirt jump bike company that was basically designed to just give people bikes that are cheap that they can afford and not have to spend lots of money. And then it sort of evolved into the company that's making the downhill bike look like the 2S that Aaron Gwin's winning World Cups and World Champs on. Like, this thing is absolutely amazing. It tells the stories of the Capra, which is probably one of the most popular enduro style bikes around there. And of course the Jeffsy, which is their 29 inch wheel bike. Aaron Gwin features heavily in there, as well as Mr. Lacondigy. So definitely have a check of this video. Well worth 15 minutes of your time. So thank you for watching. That was the very first Ask GMBN Tech. Hopefully you enjoyed it. So please don't forget to get your questions in. I'll try and answer them on next week's show. You can add them in the comments below using the hashtag AskGMBNTech, or you can just email them. The link is on the screen right now. For a couple more really cool tech related videos, click up here if you want to see the video on greases, assembly compounds and lubes, and where on your bike you need to be using them. And if you want to see the first ever GMBN Tech weekly show, click down here. As always, click on the rad little globe in the middle here to subscribe. And if you like the video, give us a thumbs up.